A very good morning to everyone. I warmly welcome all of you this Sunday morning to another webinar in our series of CBD programs for GMOA members, co-organized by the Government Medical Officers Association and the Society for Health Research and Innovation. Before we start, I would like to give you and keep you up to date on some housekeeping rules. The webinar link will be available from 9 a.m. to 9:45 a.m. to join in. There will be no late attendees entertained thereafter. Each attendee should have been attended till the end of the webinar to obtain the certificate for CPD points. And these CPD points are strictly adhered to the CPPD guidelines. Also, I would also kindly request you to switch off your video and to mute your microphone to avoid any interruptions during the CPD webinar. I would also like to encourage you to type in your queries in the chat function to be discussed at the question and answer session at the end of this session. Now, it is my privilege to introduce to you Dr. Himal Kalambarachchi, who is the acting consultant in medicine at Teaching Hospital Karapitiya, to introduce to you our esteemed webinar guest this morning. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Umali. Good morning, everyone. Today we are going to discuss regarding a timely topic, which is osteoporosis. The osteoporosis is considered as a rising public health problem. In the field, we have a lot of diagnostic and management problems. So here we will be. So we thought of this will be a really good topic discussed in the Nonshree Knowledge Academy. So it's my great privilege to introduce today's our resource person, Professor Sarath Legamasam, a chair professor in Department of Medicine, Faculty of Medicine, Duhuna, Sri Lanka. So Legamasam is considered as a world expert on osteoporosis and its management. And he is a scientific advisor for International Osteoporosis Foundation. And he has over 88 international publications related to this topic. And he has many local publications as well. He holds many fellowships in various international and local colleges. And he is the current president of Sri Lankan Society of Geriatric Medicine. Without further ado, I will invite Professor Legamasam to deliver his talk. Sir, session is over to you, sir.
Good morning, everybody. I have done many lectures during my career, and this is the first time I'm doing a lecture on integration of a trade union. And it's nice to be here. And also nice to see so many people, hundreds of people joining this webinar and on a Sunday. And I really thought that people have better things to do on Sunday. So why they have to come and listen to a webinar? Anyway, thanks, Simon, for the very kind introduction. And what I'm trying to do is next, let's say 50 minutes or so, just run through some of the practical aspects of the patient management in osteoporosis. I'm not going to actually go to the lot of theories, which does not really applicable to clinicians. And all what I say is directly applicable to your clinical practice. So end of the session, so I believe that you will be able to look at your patient with osteoporosis in a new angle. Okay, get my slides going. Okay. So objective is to introduce the subject of osteoporosis and the method of patient evaluation, the treatment options, and also address certain uncertainties which are sent to me about a couple of weeks ago, and the queries that you sent. So this is only a critical analysis based on evidence, because let's say management of patient with osteoporosis, there are deficiencies in the sense many patients who require treatment are not treated, and also many patients who are treated really doesn't deserve treatment. And so they are unnecessarily exposed to pharmacological agents. Also that I will introduce you different terms which comes up in this particular subject, like osteoporosis, DEXA, BMD, T-scope, fragility fracture. These are different concepts which comes during my lecture. So let's start from the very beginning. Sir? So if you have hyperlipidemia, the doctor says patient that you got a hyperlipidemia, you are worried whether you got acute coronary syndrome. And then if you have hypertension, then if somebody is worried whether you can get a stroke, same as a diabetes. So as I said that, you know, if you got something like a recent diabetes, you're worried whether you get a renal failure. So if you apply the same analogy, if you got osteoporosis, what you are worried about whether you will get a fracture. So these are what are called clinical endpoints. So as much as acute coronary syndrome is a clinical endpoint of hyperlipidemia, a fracture is a clinical endpoint of osteoporosis. That's what's called the hard clinical endpoint of osteoporosis. Now, if you're worried about your hyperlipidemia, it's not very difficult because you go to a lab and get your lipid profile, and what you need is actual lab analyzer, which is not a difficult thing to get. Same with the blood pressure and with the diabetes. But get a little complicated when you come to osteoporosis because the yardstick that is used to measure osteoporosis, what's called bone mineral density, which requires equipment called dual energy X-ray absorptiometry. I'm not going to the details of the machine and only going to show you the a picture of that in my presentation. So this basically has got a source of X-ray underneath the patient, which emits X-rays, which travels through the scan site. And the array of detectors in the C-arm, on the top of the C-arm you can see, and then using various mathematical calculations and models, the machine is able to determine the amount of calcium in its path, the X-ray pathway, and then give the what is called bone mineral density. Just going back to one, this one, the, I said that the fracture is the hard clinical outcome of the osteoporosis, but there are what are called not very soft clinical endpoints as well, like scoliosis. Not that all scoliosis are due to osteoporosis, but some are. Bone pain is a very, very weak association with osteoporosis. And although many people think that, you know, people with 10 years of backache has got osteoporosis, not really, unless you've got a fracture. And also people with osteoporosis are supposed to have a poor quality of life. Many studies have proven that they have poor quality of life, and also they got increased mortality. Now, bone mineral density is the density of the bone in the examining area, and also it is expressed in the gram per square centimeter. Just an illustration of the how the bone mineral density changes during the life cycle, then there's a rapid acceleration of bone mineral density during what's called the growth period, during puberty, adolescence, and then reach what is called peak bone mass. The peak bone mass reaches about between 20 and 30 years of life. And then since then, up to menopause, there's only a very little change in the bone mineral density, particularly in the female arm. And you can see that soon after menopause, there's a very rapid decline of bone mineral density. And then that continues until the old age. So then during this life cycle, you can see the men is above the curve of women. That's because they always maintain about nearly 5% of the bone mineral density higher than women throughout their life cycle. So what here we are mainly concentrating is the rapid bone loss that occurs soon after menopause and that continues during the rest of their life, rest of the life. So what happens is that what is shown in the red area is what's called the fracture zone. So if you have bone mineral density as low in that red box, and then you can get fracture. So you can see the women enter the fracture zone fairly early when you compare with men. So men enter fairly late, and since they have got a lesser risk of getting a fracture. That's a kind of, you know, normal bone. You can see how hard it is and how very well bound. And if you compare that with the, let's say, osteoporotic bone, you can see how the trabeculae got thin and particularly the connections are lost. And then what we are mainly concerned about, what are called the horizontal, vertical bars are retained until late and the horizontal bars are less. What's called loss of connectivity. And you can see redundant ends here and which are not actually connected and not supporting the structure and about to collapse. Now, the whole problem with the bone metabolism rests on two types of bone cells called osteoclast and osteoblast. And I will just describe what is called the bone turnover. What we do is during our day-to-day activities, we sustain what are called microfractures. Let's say you slip and you landed in a step below. And then you got a little pain in your let's say knee or somewhere, and that means you have got a small fracture in the bone, what are called microfractures. And during the night, osteoclast will move into this particular area and eat up that bone in that area. So in the damaged site, releases a lot of active substances, and attack osteoclast, and osteoclast will come and eat up the bone there. And then soon after that, osteoblast will move into the area and lay down a new cement in that area and heal the fracture. So really, if you look at this osteoclast, it's not a really bad chap, and he's the one who moves in and remove that dead tissue, and then osteoblast come and sort of, you know, lay down new cement in that area. It's like a very well maintained highway, and where you can't see a pothole, so everything's sort of repaired, and there's no net loss of bone mineral density. And this osteoclast, a magnified view osteoclast, and you can see the cavity that it has there, sort of, you know, created. A few words about the T-score now. Now, if you are talking about the diabetes, then the clinicians need a cutoff value. They say, give me a cutoff value to diagnose my patient with diabetes. And same applies in osteoporosis. So what we give them is what's called T-score. So T-score, it compares patient's bone mineral density with average bone mineral density of the young, a normal reference population. I said the peak bone mass is reached between 20 and 30, and that is taken as a young, normal reference population for the country. And then what you do is you compare patient's bone mineral density with the average bone mineral density of the young, normal reference population. This is again an illustration how it is done. Let's say you are 60, let's say you are about 65 years old. If I can get my cursor. This thing, yes, and then your bone mineral density is here. And you compare with what is called the young normal reference population mean value. So that's a value. And you get the gap here and then divide by the standard deviation of the young reference normal population. So when you divide that by standard deviation, you can see how many standard deviations below compared to that value. So if I give you a little example, patient bone mineral density is 0.600 for his calculation on Sunday morning. And I'm not actually doubting your mathematics. Let's say reference population has got a bone mineral density of 0.900 and a standard deviation of the reference population 0.100. So if you deduct 0.600, that patient's bone mineral density, from 0.900, that is the mean of the reference population, you end up with minus 0.300. And then if you divide by 0.100, that is the standard deviation, and you end up with minus 3. So T-score would be minus 3. And I stress on zeros because bone mineral density always is expressed to third decimal. So you can see how the T-scores are calculated. Now, when you get your DEXA report, pay attention to bone mineral density. You will be going to bone mineral density. This is a T1 to T4 in the PA projection. So there's a bone mineral density for different vertebrae, and then put together collectively, total is here, gram per square centimeter, right here, and then the T-scores of individual vertebrae are here, and then this is the average of the listing which we consider, right? So you can see the T-score as well as bone mineral density. And same with the proximal femur. The proximal femur has got called femoral neck here, and also total hip and two regions. Again, we'll have bone mineral density and T-scores. So this is just only an example of a DEXA report that you might see. Now the T-score, what is the all this, you know, great thing about T-score? Now, when we started work on osteoporosis, when I was a registrar, and then we had no guidelines how the diagnosis of osteoporosis should be made. In 1994, the WHO study group, headed by Professor Keynes, and then they studied this huge database, European and North American database, and then by various calculations, and they determined what are called T-score based diagnostic thresholds of osteoporosis. Now, in that one, they said that the diagnosis of osteoporosis should be based on the T-score, and when it is less than minus 2.5, and then you can diagnose somebody with osteoporosis. Very technical type of diagnosis. And if you have a T-score greater than minus 1, then you are considered a normal bone mineral density, that's within one standard deviation. But you are between one standard deviation and 2.5 standard deviation below the mean value, then you are considered to have what's called osteopenia. They have no idea what the osteopenia mint at that time, but at least we know something about osteopenia now. The severe osteoporosis is not is when you have osteoporosis plus the patient has got a fragility fracture. So that's called severe osteoporosis. Now, there is a definition of osteoporosis, again, came in 1993. I don't want you to remember that, you know, but just want to highlight some of the key principles in this definition. It's a systematic skeletal disease. It's the most prevalent metabolic bone disease in the world. And it is associated with a low bone mass and a microarchitectural deterioration of the bone tissue with a subsequent increase in bone fragility. Now, remember that three concepts here, the low bone mass, the microarchitectural deterioration, and increase in bone fragility, all three should be met when you try to diagnose osteoporosis. So, really speaking, what happened was that some people, when a patient has a low BMD, they try to say this patient got osteoporosis, it's wrong. Because when you take 2 standard deviation or 2.5 standard deviation as cutoff value, you will know that certain percentage of the people in the normal population can be in that area. That doesn't mean that, you know, those people are abnormal, like taking height and the weight. A very short person that, you know, who's falling less than 2.5 standard deviation below is not considered to be abnormal. Maybe constitutional, a short stature, same thing. So a person with osteoporosis should have a low BMD, and in addition, you should be able to demonstrate microarchitectural deterioration and also increased fracture risk. So when a certain, let's say for people who had a economical interest and is starting doing a community screening and then detecting people with a low bone mineral density, we had to move in and protest and say that that should not be done because low BMD does not mean osteoporosis. Now, common site of fracture, any fracture is possible. You can get a penis fracture, you can get a slip fracture, but then common is what are called the typical sites for the fracture in osteoporosis, including fracture, the vertebral fracture, and wrist fracture. Also, you can get what is called the neck of humerus fracture. It's also classical, and also rib fracture is also on the classical sites. You can get fractures. Now, what are the causes of osteoporosis? Now, this is the etiology, the genetic and non-genetic. Now, nearly 65% of the variation of the bone mineral density is genetically determined. And everything else will determine only 45% of the bone mineral density or 35% of the bone mineral density variation. This is one of the major problems that we have when you are trying to correct bone mineral density, because it's only a 35% of the bone mineral density under your control, because the rest under genetic control for which you have no actual handle and you can't control that. So non-genetic factors again include some of them which are not sort of, you know, changeable and modifiable, like age and the gender. But there are ones which are really modifiable, like let's say gonadal failure, amenopause. Diseases like, you know, there's a whole range of endocrine diseases, hypothyroidism, hyperparathyroidism, Cushing's, like that, there are so many inflammatory diseases, particularly rheumatoid arthritis, rheumatoid inflammatory arthritis, inflammatory bowel disease, polymyalgia rheumatica, chancellor, whatever inflammatory disease is associated with osteoporosis. There are various bowel disorders, including malabsorption and going up to inflammatory bowel disease, and there are other diseases as well. I'm not going to give you a whole list and say which one that can be included in the slide. When you come to drugs, particularly we are talking about what's called glucocorticoids. That's the main agent of which induces clinical osteoporosis. And excess thyroxine, not the usual replacement of thyroxine, excess thyroxine, like when you give for patient with thyroid malignancies, to give a supra pharmacological doses. Heparin given more than 7 days can induce osteoporosis, anti-cancer. Lifestyle factors like physical inactivity, and those are some of the causes of osteoporosis. Now, let's run through the indications for DEXA. This is one of the questions which was posed, and then this is one of the major problems that we have in the country. Now, countries like, let's say, USA, Europe, and Singapore, Japan, the countries, they're very actually rigid when these indications for DEXA. Not that you know, just go and have a DEXA scan done. It actually, the indicator in women who are more than 65 years old or 65 years or more, regardless of their clinical risk factors and complaints, should be scrutiny done on women who are more than 65 years. But if a woman less than 65 years asking for a DEXA, there has to be a minimum of at least one clinical risk factor. And I'm going to talk about clinical risk factors in one of those slides. As I said, that the men have, they are not that they are sitting pretty and they can't say, no, we don't get osteoporosis. They do get osteoporosis, but at a little late. And then that is actually, we have pushed it back to another 10 years. So men more than 75 years and should get a DEXA scan. And if a man less than 75 years has requesting, then there should be a minimum of at least minimum of one clinical risk factor. There are patients with diseases. There are patient diseases which cause bone loss, as I told you earlier, like inflammatory bowel disease at whatever age group. Patients on drug which causes bone loss, regardless of age, and there are other indications which are very subtle. I think 99% of the requests would come within those categories. The clinical risk factors include parental history of fragility fracture, a previous fracture, a very good one, inflammatory arthritis, smoking and alcohol, not a huge problem among our female. The use of glucocorticoids, we have a couple of guidelines we developed and one developed in, I think, 2000 for the Royal College of Physicians, London. And then we revised it in 2012. Glucocorticoid induced osteoporosis guidelines for the IOF. And we said that if person has taken or intend to take more than 5 milligrams of prednisone or equivalent for more than 3 months, let's say you haven't taken, but then you are going to, let's say, if you're having a disease, something like a giant cell arteritis, and you start on something like 40 milligrams of prednisone, and you know that that need to be continued at least about 18 months. So that's patient need DEXA. Other drugs, a secondary cause of osteoporosis or fracture, and there are many other. The main problem with osteoporosis treatment is that to find out who requires treatment, who does not require treatment. So in a country where the indications for DEXA is not very tightly regulated, then unnecessarily a group of people who are innocent people, they receive treatment. For example, a person who's 55 years can just, get a backache of 20 years, which has nothing to do with osteoporosis, and then get DEXA scan, and then they get treated. So this is something really happening in some of the Asian countries where these regulatory checks and balances are not really strictly followed. Okay. Now, this actually I have highlighted at the beginning of my lecture, undertreat those who have a high fracture risk. For example, most of the hip fracture patients who are discharged are not given the adequate treatment so that second fracture can be prevented. But this is not local phenomenon. I'm not actually criticizing the local. This is because of global phenomenon. Even in the countries like the USA, you can see only about 25% of those patients are being properly treated. And about 50% of patients are just on calcium and vitamin D. So what happens is they fall the next time and then they get another fracture on the other side of the hip. Also, overtreat those who don't have high fracture risk. I said that 55-year-old woman with a 10-year backache, no clinical risk factors, and get a DEXA scan done for no good clinical reason and found her low BND, which is entirely physiological, and that person has to undergo a treatment. Now, I'm showing you again because this is entirely due to what is called the misunderstanding among the clinicians. Although in 1994, Professor Keynes and his group developed these guidelines, they never thought that the clinician would extrapolate the diagnostic categorization to make therapeutic decisions. So since the clinician had got something to hang on, and then actually we welcome this cutoff values when they were published for the first time. And again, we were in the idea that if you got osteoporosis, all those patients would fracture. If you got normal bone mineral density, and those people would not fracture. And then osteopenia, of course, we had no idea whether they will fracture or not. So we thought there's a little hierarchical arrangement in the fracture occurrence where the patient with osteoporosis would fracture, normal people would not fracture, and osteopenic patients are in big pain, which is of course completely a misunderstanding. And also that the T-score-based classification gives you what is called relative risk. Every time it drops by one standard deviation, that is T-score by minus one, and you increase your relative risk of fracture by twofold. But then if you don't have an absolute fracture risk at the baseline is very low, and then when you multiply by two, you are not coming into a substantial fracture risk. This is one of the problems that we had with very early on. And also this particular approach completely disregard other clinical risk factors and the role played by other clinical risk factors completely disregarded. So we had this situation, otherwise normal, a 65-year-old woman with a backache and a spine T-score minus 2.5, they likely to get treated. But let's say a 65-year-old woman with a Parkinson's disease with a recurrent pulse, spine T-score minus 2.2, because she had degenerative changes and osteophytes in the spine, and it PMD is elevated, and she would not get treatment. And also 65-year-old woman with a GCA, giant arthritis on prednisone 40 milligrams, spine T-score minus 2, also would not get treated. But you will agree, as clinicians, you will agree that patient number 2 and 3 are the ones who are very likely to fracture when you compare with the patient number 1. But this kind of approach that we were in earlier did not allow us to treat patient number 2 and 3. Well, we could have done again, but then, you know, it's a little the deviation, but then people were happily treating patient number 1, not number 2 and 3. The major insult to that kind of understanding among clinicians came from this large body of epidemiological data in 2004. And you can see that I'm trying to explain a little bit on this slide. You can see that T-scores, you can see the T-scores, they deteriorate in this way. So T-scores become worse and worse like this. And the fracture risk, this is a fracture risk. What are the red bars are the fracture risk, increases exponentially. If I said that every time it drops by one standard deviation, it doubles, so that it is so exponentially increases. If you understand mathematics, that's not difficult to understand. But if you look at the really people who are getting fractures, you can see that most of the patients who are getting fractures are in the osteopenic range, not in osteoporotic range. True, that patient osteoporotic range is also their fracture, and as much as people with a normal bone density also develop fractures. But the bulk of the patient came from the osteopenic range. So when this data came in 2004, it was a bit an eye-opener. And then what the WHO did was, they asked Professor Keynes and his group to get back the drawing boards and see whether what can be done to come out of this situation. Now, for the first time, we realized that what is important is the high risk of fracture more than the diagnosis of osteoporosis. So if a patient goes to a doctor, rather than saying that, you know, got high blood pressure, I think probably, let's say cholesterol, go to the doctor. And then I think estimating that patients, the probability of getting a cardiac condition during the next 10 years would be the more rational approach, rather than saying that with your cholesterol high or not, because there are other factors also into the equation. Now, what are the methods that what are things that they suggested? Well, if you have a history of fragility fracture, and those patients have a high risk of getting another fracture. So also that patient with a fragility fracture, you understand there's a microarchitecture deterioration, otherwise they can't get a fracture. So people with a fragility fracture, they have a low bone mineral density by epidemiological data. And also they got a microarchitecture deterioration, and also they got a high risk of fracture. So they fulfill all three criteria of osteoporosis, and they require treatment. So if you got a fragility fracture, the fragility fracture is a fracture which is sustained with the low energy. For example, you slip in the bathroom and fall, or you trip and fall, and then you got a fragility fracture. So if you have fall of standing height or less, that's called fragility fracture. But if you hit by a bus and then, you know, got thrown away and get a fracture, and that's not actually a fragility fracture, although you can have osteoporosis and you have broken your old bones, but that does not actually belong to the definition of fragility fracture. So it's a low energy fracture occurring of a standing height or less. So that patient requires treatment. There's a uniform agreement among all the guidelines. This patient needs treatment, patient with a fragility fracture. Right, okay. Now, patient presenting with the osteoporotic fracture requires treatment regardless of BMD results. So that's what I'm trying to highlight. Then the question comes, would you do a baseline DEXA at all? So this is one of the questions that, you know, we often put on us. And people are asking for an answer. Let's say you are working in a place like, let's say, Mundragala or Shillong, where you have no access to DEXA, and you found a person who has got a vertebral fracture, and you believe it's a fragile fracture, and you have extruded secondary causes like multiple myeloma, malignancies, and we are ready to treat. And question comes, should you do a baseline DEXA at all? It's desirable, but not essential. Why it is important? Because you can use it to monitor treatment. And then I'll tell you in my later slide how it can be handy. You can recognize what about treatment failures. The small, very, very small group of people who would not have a treatment benefit, and so they can be recognized. And also, it's better way to convince people that, you know, relatives, and because otherwise the drug adherence becomes very bigger problem with these people. People are happy to take, let's say, hypertension medication, cholesterol medication. But when you come say you've got osteoporosis in your back, and then you take this drug to prevent a fracture, then they look at you and say, well, is it really essential? So if you've got a DEXA report in front of you, you can show that and you can try to convince patients. And studies have shown very clearly that the better medication adherence association with, if you discuss with their patient at the baseline with the DEXA report in hand. The second thing is, if the patient has not got a fragile fracture, and then it is based on the fracture probability, that is, a probability of getting a fracture within next 10 years. It is determined by the country-specific risk scores. Now, for example, if somebody is worried whether you've got a coronary syndrome or vascular event, and they can go to ASCVD risk score, and then calculate your probability of getting a cardiac vascular event within next 10 years. So similarly, there are what are called risk scores, and which will say whether you will predict whether you get a fracture during the next 10 years. And the good example, what is called the fracture risk assessment model, developed by Professor Keynes and all. Now, this FRAX consider, there are three fundamental things that it considers. It says that BMD is not the sole determinant for fracture. Now, that is a actually, one of the things that, you know, mistake that we did, and also other determinants, and they come from very large epidemiological data, and say what are the determinants of fractures, other determinants of fractures. Now, we realize that the fracture occurrence varies in country. There's a geographical variation, huge geographical variation. This is the occurrence of the fracture. And you can see that the Scandinavian countries and Northern Europe has a very high risk of getting fracture when you compare with some of the Asian countries. And still, we are unable to find out what was this, why this discrepancy between geographical discrepancy, and people are having a lot of hypotheses, but then not really understood. And also, you can see that how the fracture risk increases when you keep on adding risk factors. I'm not going to go over details. And then you can add another risk factor, it goes up. Another risk factor goes up. So you can see that there's an interaction of the risk factors. So there are other slides which I actually skipped here. Now, let's say in the algorithm, if you say, have you got rheumatoid arthritis, iron glucocorticoids, have you got a prior fracture? So the way you answer will determine your fracture probability. If you say no, 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 and then three, and then your fracture probability is here. But if you say yes to all three questions, and then your fracture probability will be here, as big as 35%. So in between, you can find out, you know, what is the fracture probability based on the answer that you would give. So this is how the algorithm works. And then based on that, the fracture probability was developed, and it has several this country is country dependent, and then this is how the input you put in the input. The Sri Lankan FRAX model we got in 2012, and in fact Professor Keynes developed that for me, and this came to effect in 2012, and at that time even India, some countries in the, you know, very giants in Asia did not have a FRAX models for their countries at that time. The FRAX takes the, let's say, age, male or female, gender, height and weight, And then previous fracture, parenteral stress fracture, smoking, glucocorticoids, rheumatoid arthritis, a secondary osteoporosis, this can be found somewhere else, the alcohol. So that those are what are called clinical inputs, and then it takes a femoral neck BMD into the equation. And you, the moment you press your button and you get this kind of output, 10-year fracture risk, a major osteoporotic fracture probability 5.7%, and the hip fracture risk is 0.1%. So that is the kind of, you know, output you might see. Now, so a newer approach is now you take the clinical risk factors and the BMD and use Sri Lankan FRAX model, and then you get what is called your probability of getting a fracture, so which run from 0% to 100%. And then you take what is called a certain value, the cutoff value, where you say above which you would treat and below which you would not treat, what's called intervention thresholds. So the intervention threshold we have worked out for Sri Lanka. And then in the most recent evaluation that we have done and published says that if you've got a major osteoporotic fracture probability more than 9% or hip fracture probability more than 3%, that those people, they require treatment. So intervention threshold for that is 9% and 3%, 3% for hip fracture and then 9% for major osteoporotic fracture. But this varies from country to country. Now, let's say you are working in a place where you have no access to DEXA. And this is another question that is asked, common questions we ask in lectures. Let's say I'm working in a remote area, I don't have access to DEXA. Let's say I've got a 75-year-old woman with a backache, only had hypertension and asthma. Patient mother had a hip fracture, no falls and no fracture, no previous fracture, weight missing and the height 1.68 meters. The son asked the question, has my mother got osteoporosis? And what are the options that doctor has in that setup? Of course, you can refer that patient to, let's say, take X-ray, or you can, let's say, look for a vertebral fracture. If present, you exclude secondary causes and confirm that's a vertebral fracture, not radiologic mimic, and then you can treat the patient. As I said earlier, because patients with fragile fracture, they need treatment. Or you can refer the patient to nearest DEXA center. Well, that may be difficult. All you can do is you can calculate fracture probabilities with Sri Lankan FRAX model without BMD input. And then you can use the intervention thresholds and then you can start treatment. So you can convince some center, well, don't worry too much whether they have shared osteoporosis or not. But I can tell you what is the likelihood of getting a fracture during the next 10 years. And then you can convince the patient and the son on that. Now, whether Sri Lankan FRAX model will work without BMD input, as good as with BMD input, we have at least two publications we are saying that the FRAX model, Sri Lankan FRAX model, not only Sri Lankan FRAX model, all the FRAX models, they work without BMD input as good as a with BMD input. So that is something to be, you know, happy about. Now, also I should say a little bit about the NOF guidelines in the USA. Now the NOF refers to National Osteoporosis Foundation guidelines in the USA. This is one of the most misused guidelines in the world, including Sri Lanka. Now, NOF, actually, the National Osteoporosis Foundation recommends intervention threshold for those who has got osteoporosis in the BMD evaluation. And then if you don't have osteoporosis, you have got osteopenia, then they look at a major osteoporotic fracture probability more than 20% and hip fracture probability more than 3% for those with the osteopenia. Now, this particular guidelines were developed in 2009, so you can consider that it's quite old. And also, it was built on what is called economic principles. This completely ran on the economic model. And the economic model considered that alendronate as the main treatment. But now there are many other treatment options are available. So this is fairly old model, economic principle in 2009. And it is believed that this is valid only for the US, because those economic principles can be applied to, let's say, Sri Lanka or Malaysia or Philippines. So this model cannot be applied to other countries. But then many countries, they follow the guidelines, I should say, quite blindly. And they don't understand it. Now, many Asian countries who were using the intervention therapy, following the NIOSH guidelines, actually now switch to their own guidelines. Now, the Singapore developed their facts-based intervention thresholds, and I was involved with the calculation in 2018, and where Manju Chandran actually shared the publication, and then later there was another publication with Rosie Kanis, and again they reconfirmed almost like the same values. We have just published in 2011, about a month ago, we developed same thing for the Philippines, and Philippine intervention thresholds were also developed and they were published. And currently I'm working with the Malaysia, develop Malaysian intervention thresholds. The Sri Lankan intervention thresholds were developed in 2013, but then they were revised in 2019. The 9% and 3% are the ones which is in the revised model, and the old model says 11% and 3%, but the new model says 9% and 3%. I believe 9% and 3% are more valid because the I think calculations were more robust in the second one, and also database was bigger. Now, treatment options, just run through treatment options. The aim of treatment is prevention of fracture, either the first fracture or subsequent fracture, and also all types of fractures. So the drug that we are using should have what is called anti-fracture efficacy. Now earlier, when the drugs were approved, they look at what is called improvement of bone mineral density only. The study showed that there's improvement bone mineral density, significant improvement, and then they were approved. But now you can't do that. People don't look at the BMD, and people more are concerned about whether they can prevent a fracture, what's called anti-fracture efficacy. And they should prevent either first fracture or subsequent fracture, and also should prevent all types of fracture, and also should improve quality of life. There are a lot of questions of non-pharmacologic management, nutrition, and in a simple term, what you need is adequate protein and calcium throughout life. Now, this is important during, let's say, during your growth period in the middle age and also in the old age. And you have adequate protein and calcium intake right throughout. But then remember that older adults have a higher requirement. For example, they need nearly about calcium, 1,200, 1,500 milligrams of calcium per day. And also their protein requirement as high as 1 gram per kilogram per day. So let's say if somebody is 60 kilograms would require about 6 grams of protein, which is very high requirement. About exercise, at a young age, what you are trying to do is exercises to maximize peak bone mass. So if you do exercises during your, let's say, prepubertal and pubertal age, and then what you do is you get into a higher peak bone mass. And what are important are what's called weight-bearing exercises that we know. And let's say cycling, walking, running would be more beneficial than swimming. And also, sort of, you know, if you do jumping up and down, like, you know, skipping ropes and all, that would be more beneficial because those are what's called weight-bearing exercises. In the middle age, what you're trying to do is you're trying to maintain bone mineral density that you gathered. You come to a peak bone mass, you're trying to maintain and you don't allow it to get lost. So running and walking would be the best thing to do at that time. And if you are happy to continue with what you have done in your young age, I'm certain you are the person is most welcome to do that. In the old age, without a fracture, what you're trying to do is prevent BMD loss and falls. So walking, I don't think running would be the same. Walking would be the most sort of appropriate thing to do. But with the fracture, it should be under the guidance of physio. Now the people with, let's say, hip fracture, the guidelines say patient should be mobilized within first 24 hours, at least 48 hours, patient should be mobilized. So yeah, the physio get involved very early. And also patients with what are called vertebral fractures. And then again, after, let's say, rest period of, let's say, maybe 1 week or so, and unless you had surgery, and again, certain amount of mobilization and a small gentle exercises under the supervision of physiotherapists can relieve pain and also improve mobility. So not that you put them on six weeks of absolute bed rest and then, you know, forget about, but some people, they start physio fairly early, but under the guidance of physiotherapists. Now, studies have shown that most effective method would be to combine exercise with the nutrition, and that is where the most sort of, you know, best benefits are achieved. And prevention of falls in as a non-farm project management is very important. And it is another lecture by itself, so I'm not going to the details. Calcium, patients are asked about calcium. Calcium and bone, if you try to separate, they cannot be separated because calcium, bone is calcium as much as teeth. They're inseparable concepts. But calcium deficiency leads to low BMD, but there's more osteomalacia than osteoporosis. But calcium supplements can increase bone mineral density in young, you know, growing children and also postmenopausal women. But one thing to remember that there's no effect on the fracture occurrence. So calcium studies have shown that it does not reduce fracture occurrence. It can increase bone mineral density a little bit, but do not prevent the fracture. Now, pharmacologic treatment prevent bone. There are ones which prevent bone resorption. So that was called inhibit osteoclast. I showed you the chapu sort of eroded the bone. They're called anti-resorptives. Now there are drugs which promote bone formation. They induce osteoclast, and then they're called anabolics. Now there are ones with the dual action. There are other drugs like vitamin D and derivatives. This is a list of drugs because I have no time to go through all the drugs. Actually, what I highlighted in gray, in blue are the ones which are available in Sri Lanka. But again, denosumab is not available at the bottom, and it's a mistake. Alendronate, resipronate, solidronic acid, and ibendronate are available as much as teriparatide. So first four drugs, alendronate, resipronate, solidronic acid, and ibendronate belong to what's called bisphosphonate group. They increase spine BMD. They reduces fractures, both vertebral and non-vertebral fractures they reduce. The selective estrogen receptor modulator, raloxifene, is not very much in the use because it does not reduce hip fracture. It only prevents the first vertebral fracture and subsequent vertebral fracture. Teriparatide is good, but the only thing is pretty expensive. It's prohibitively expensive in Sri Lanka, and it costs about maybe 6,000 to 7,000 per month. The strontium renalate came with a big bang and it went off, so strontium people are not using that. And the vitamin D and calcitriol, there's a little bit of evidence that in some people it can prevent fracture, but largely people believe that they cannot prevent fracture. Denosumab is a new drug which has come to the market, and it's again a very effective treatment, but it's not available in Sri Lanka yet. So bisphosphonate increased bone mineral density by 2 to 5% and reduced fracture by 20 to 30 to 50%. So you can see that the increase in BMD is very little, but the fracture reduction is quite substantial. So they are not actually parallel. They are very well tolerated, this drug. The period of treatment should be, let's say, oral drug should be given for 5 years and IV drug should be given for 3 years in the first phase. And then end of that, you reevaluate and decide. And the criteria to stop treatment, another question that somebody has asked. When there's an improvement in BMD from the baseline, now the other is a baseline DEXA scan comes again. So there should be some improvement in the bone mineral density from the baseline value. And also no incident fracture while on treatment, that patient did not have a fracture during the treatment. And no new clinical risk factor added while on treatment. Let's say you only had rheumatoid arthritis at the beginning when you calculated fracture probabilities, but then later, 6 months later, patients start getting steroids, and then there's a new clinical risk factor added. Okay, so there shouldn't be a new clinical risk factor added. And also, femoral neck T score is more than greater than minus 2.0. So, if you achieved all these things, and then you can say you can stop treatment, but otherwise, you can continue treatment. So, patient treatment can be extended up to 10 years, like. With the yearly evaluations, I put 3 asterisks there because there you need to discuss with the patient as such as your relatives, because this is where you find certain adverse effects coming in. So you can't just give them for 10 years treatment. You need to have a close supervision on these people and sort of, you know, make them aware of possible side effects, and then have a yearly evaluation and terminate treatment at the first opportunity. What are the adverse effects? I will highlight more on the acute phase. Reactions are the commonest ones, like musculoskeletal pain, cramps, and fevers, or take paracetamol for 2-3 days when they take treatment at the beginning. Gastrointestinal ones are the other thing, and particularly you have to be mindful about the people with hepatitis or their abnormalities. And there's a way to take treatment. I'm not going to go to the P test because they eat early in the morning with a large glass of water, flushes flush it down and then remain upright for half an hour, type of thing. Don't eat anything afterwards. What we are really worried about in the long term side effects are the osteonecrosis of the jaw, that is unhealing of ulcers in the jaw and atypical fractures. I had two patients with atypical fractures in the prolonged this thing, but they're not common. Teriparatide is a part of parathormone. It's only part of the component of parathormone. It's an anabolic agent. It stimulates osteoblast functions. And then it's a monthly injections for 18 months. The cost is quite prohibitive. Safety concerns are there. Should be limited to those who are most severely affected, not each and every one. The first line of treatment is alendronate. A bisphosphonate is the first line of treatment, and particularly alendronate, but not teriparatide. 18 months maximum for 2 years. Denosumab is a monoclonal antibody, and it's a 60 milligram subcutaneous injection every 6 months. And then it is particularly useful for people with malignancies, and particularly prostate malignancies. Now, I have not discussed actually SERM, paroxetine, calcitonin, strontium granulate, and HRT. And there are a couple of questions on HRT. HRT increases bone mineral density, reduces fracture. That information came from Women Health Initiative study. But then there are a lot of side effects. There are a lot of safety concerns about breast cancer and endometrial cancer. So there are more effective treatments which are fairly reasonably, have a reasonable side effects profile. So because of that, these drugs are usually kept away and the people don't consider them. Vitamin D3 is a mandatory for prescription. They should be given vitamin D3, 800,000 international units per day. And what I've seen is actually some people are on about four different preparations of vitamin D, which is quite unnecessary. And some people get into what's called iatrogenic hypercalcemia. And vitamin D derivatives, unfortunately, in Sri Lanka, for some reason, calcitriol and the 1-alpha derivatives are available in the hospital, and which are pretty expensive when you compare to vitamin D3. I don't know the reason. There are expensive risk of hypercalcemia there, because you must monitor calcium level when the patients are on vitamin D derivatives, but not from vitamin D3. Particularly useful derivatives are useful in renal disease, liver disease, and also in very elderly people, where you have a problem with the absorption of vitamin D3 due to a problem with the carrier protein in the mucosa. Newer therapies have come, lasofoxifene and the bezodoxifene is a newer SERMs. Sclerotin inhibitor romosumab, we are currently doing a meta-analysis on Romo, and newer PTH derivatives also come into the picture, but some of these are available in European countries. So, trying to beat my deadline and leave about 5 minutes for discussion, I'm coming to my summary slide. So, many high-risk patients are undertreated, untreated, or partial treated. So, patient with hip fracture goes on with only about, let's say, 25% people getting a drug which has anti-fracture efficacy, but other people are getting calcium and vitamin D, and some people are not getting anything. Many low-risk patients are being treated irrationally, and that is to be blamed. And I think it is something that people don't think about. Attention should be paid to the fracture risk rather than diagnosis of osteoporosis. This, I think, same thing applies in other diseases like lipids. Aim of treatment to prevention of fracture, many options are available, but bisphosphonates will lead the market, and because it's a cheap, it's a cost-effective and effective drug. Serious side effects are not uncommon, and particularly when you're extending the treatment beyond 5 years and beyond 3 years, and then you have to be mindful about them. The cost constraints comes to when you have there are people who need teriparatide in my practice, but then every time I suggest that people say, no, look, I can't do it. I have no money. They sprinkle, they are older people, and they haven't got that much of financial sort of stability to that. Thank you. So, if there are questions, I'm not happy to answer.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for that fascinating talk regarding practical approach in managing osteoporosis. So, we received multiple questions from pre-registrants as well as chat through the chat. So, okay. I'll start with the pre-registrants. Mm-hmm. The first one is
spondylolisthesis. Will it be considered as a vertebral fracture?
No, absolutely no. because spondylolisthesis is that the slipping of vertebra on other vertebra, and that is I'm not actually a rheumatologist, but then you know, due to a weakness of one of those ligaments, pars something, I can't remember, one of the ligaments become weaker, and as a result of that, one vertebra slips forward over the other vertebra. That's a spondylolisthesis, nothing to do with osteoporosis, and it's not a fracture really.
Right, so there's a grading
for that. You can work out the grading. Yes. There's 1, 2, 3 grading, and then depending on that, you can sort of, you know, take treatment decisions.
Right. So a lot of question came through the line of atypical femoral fractures.
Hmm.
So the most questions ask, is it due to prolonged cause of bisphosphonate?
There are atypical fractures can occur due to various reasons. What radiologists call actually insufficient fractures. But what are associated with the osteoporosis treatment, there are two main drugs. One is bisphosphonate, other one is the denosumab. They both can cause atypical fractures. Atypical fracture usually occurs with a prolonged treatment. But one of my patients fractured just after 4.5 years. Other patient fractured at 10.5 years. But the typical thing is about it. The typical thing about the atypical fracture is the clinical presentation. They have a sharp pain in the mid-thigh. So they usually wake up during the night with a very sharp pain, and then does not respond to usual painkillers. At that time, if you start, you know, try to mobilize patient and they fall, patient falls and get a fracture. At the very beginning, what they get is a very small crack in the cortical area, which can be diagnosed with the MRI, and even X-ray may not detect that. So if you think that patient got very, very sharp pain in the thigh, don't mobilize the patient and get MRI, and then you might see. Recently, the DEXA manufacturers are trying to get a DEXA scan, particularly in that area, with a little bit of, you know, shall we say, more resolution, so that those fractures can be detected. For that software we haven't got, and then people are not using that very much because it's a much easier to MRI scan. So, the treatment of choice is internal fixation, and you must quickly change the patient's medication. So both patients that I had actually, and they were discharged on same treatment. So usual treatment given for the atypical fracture is a periperitite, because they fractured you either on denosumab or on bisphosphonate, and then treatment is usually denosumab. Sorry, treatment is periperitite.
Right, sir. There are a lot of questions coming through the chat, sir. So the selected one, people are asking that vitamin D and other prophylactic therapy, can it reduce the risk of osteoporosis?
Yes, it is essential that, you know, I mean, this saga about, let's say, debate about vitamin D is always there. And it is essential that people have sufficient vitamin D level and also sufficient calcium intake and also exercises. So if you get them together, like calcium, vitamin D, and also adequate nutrition and exercises, and certainly, I mean, you can, first of all, you can improve your bone mineral density, have a higher bone mineral density at the end of your linear growth. So you put more sort of your money in your account, like. And then from where you start losing, so you're losing the higher point. And then again, exercises and then the nutrition can reduce your bone retarded missing during the middle age and the old age. Yes, it's those are vital components in osteoporosis. But whether they will prevent a fracture is the main concern. People have not yet proven that there's a prophylactic use of vitamin D to prevent fractures. People don't use that. But if you think the patient has got a condition where vitamin D deficiency occurs, like renal failure, liver failure, old age, malabsorption, and all that, you know, the poor sun exposure and limited mobility, people don't go out, and then, you know, vitamin D supplements okay, and that will prevent a certain amount of, you know, bone loss. But whether that prevent a fracture is a huge concern, because studies are not supporting that.
Right, sir. Thank you, sir. There are a couple of questions coming to line of that 9% of major osteoporosis fracture and 3% of hip fracture. Is it the value applicable to the men? And is it validated through the line to manage patient in Sri Lanka?
Yes. Very good question. In that actually, the staples, I'm supposed to do another lecture, what's called Meet Expert session on 1st of December in Bangkok meeting, Asia Pacific Osteoporosis Conference. And half an hour lecture, what's called male osteoporosis, which is completely a less well studied area. And because the prominence has been given for the female osteoporosis, the studies have shown that men and women, they fracture the same BMD thresholds, and this has been debated for a long, long time. But finally, everybody agree that, you know, it's the same bone threshold, bone mineral density threshold that, you know, that men and women fracture. In fact, in the calculation T-scores in men, we use female data. And men didn't like it actually at the very beginning when this was suggested, but then now it is all agree that the female bone mineral density reference values are used in the calculation T-scores in men as well. The intervention thresholds are equal to men as well. So same intervention thresholds we give for men and women. Have you validated? No country has actually validated. Let's say what you need is a group of women, a large group of aged people who have not got fracture, and do their DEXA and then, you know, determine the fracture probability at the baseline and follow them a period of maybe 10 years or so and see how many of those people will develop fracture. Now, no country has done that. And then, you know, it's because it's quite costly, and then it is beyond sort of, you know, your reach, like, you know, financially as well as, you know, resources and all that logistically is not doable. So these intervention thresholds have been done in cross-sectional studies, not in, let's say, cohort studies. But the cohort studies, people are not actually trying to do that. Even in, let's say, hypertension, cholesterol and diabetes, people are not doing these cohort studies, and they are very much actually cross-sectional analysis giving these risk ratios.
Thank you, sir. There are continuous coming on the things. People ask once a resource, a guideline to read regarding osteoporosis, the international guideline. Can you recommend a couple of readings for them, sir?
I think one of the sites would be the International Osteoporosis Foundation website. And IOF website has got a lot of what I call position statements as well as a lot of guidelines. So I think it's one of the good place to go and visit IOF website. And also National Osteoporosis Foundation, apart from their guidelines, the material given on subject matter is quite good. So I would recommend it, NOF website as well as IOF website. And then so if you want to get me, you know, more knowledge about osteoporosis.
We have one last question, sir.
Mm-hmm.
How do we monitor the treatment response using DEXA scan, and what are the drug holiday? What is the drug holiday, and how we manage patient with the drug holidays?
Oh, I thought, okay, hang on. I didn't use the word drug holiday, but I think I gave the concept. What was the question? Sorry. How you monitor?
How you monitor DEXA?
Okay, right. This highly debated area, because the world is actually divided into two on this matter. Like, some people believe that patients should be sort of monitored with the DEXA scan on year basis, and some people believe it is actually a waste of time and money. I'm not going to say where I belong, but then, you know, I'll tell you some, you know, principles in that. Let's say when you have a, let's say, baseline DEXA, and then you repeat the DEXA after, let's say, 1 to 2 years if the patient is on bisphosphonate. Ideal should be 2 years, but some people do it as early as 1 year, and then see where there is a substantial improvement bone mineral density. Right? Let's say if the patient has got a substantial improvement bone mineral density, and you say, well, let's say Mrs. A, you have responded very well, you continue treatment. Let's say the patient has no change in the bone mineral density. Again, you say that you have prevented bone loss. Otherwise, if you did not treat, the patient would have lost about 5-3% of the bone during that 1 year period. And again, you say you continue treatment. Let's say somebody has lost BMD and it's not an indication to stop treatment. where you see you continue for another 1 year, come back after 1 year, we do another scan and see. So regardless of bone mineral density change at that, you know, occurring at 1 year, you usually continue treatment, right? So, but again, if you continue to lose BMD while on treatment, those people are considered to be treatment failures, right? Because at somewhere down the line, there should be an improvement in bone mineral density. What people generally highlight is that the bone mineral density, where people fail to get bone mineral density improvement, simply because they are not compliant. The compliance is very poor with bisphosphonate, and people don't take that, you know, because of various reasons. So, really speaking, it is much more, more beneficial for you to check the compliance, and particularly with regard to vitamin D and calcium intake, and of course take the compliance with the medication, the anti, let's say, bisphosphonate medication. And then I think what I generally do is every clinic visit I insist on those, the adequate calcium and adequate vitamin D3. And sometimes people just don't take vitamin D3 and take on the other tablet. So that's how you monitor. Third thing comes, second question was on
what is the
drug holiday? Yes, okay. Drug holiday comes after 3 years of bisphosphonate. Say IV solidrenic acid, 3 years, you come to a drug holiday. Oral bisphosphonate after 5 years, you come to a drug holiday. If you think that you can stop treatment, you know, if you can stop treatment, you withhold treatment for 1 year, and then you think of restarting. The reason is that just take another, let's say, 2-3 minutes, and then I had to go for the explain the why. Let's say you should not inhibit osteoclast too long. I said osteoclast is not a bad check. He's the one who comes and eats up that area of the bone and then relay the bone. So if you, let's say, inhibit touch up, you know, doing that work, and your microfractures will accumulate. So after 5 years, your microfractures would accumulate, they're unrepaired, and then you have collapse of the whole structure. And that is one of the reasons why you get atypical fractures. So you allow the osteoclast to come back and, you know, do this repair job, and that is given for 1 year. That's what's called drug holiday. And during that, you make sure they do enough exercises and take adequate calcium and vitamin D3 and not the main drug. And then you think of restarting the treatments. That's what's called drug holiday.
Thank you, sir. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for the fascinating explanation. Actually, we are lucky to have you here to this section as a
thank you for the invitation.
This is a message for housekeeping message for the audience. We have already published the data sheets to questions, post evaluation questions, to your chat box. So please fill it and send to us. Then, irrespective of those marks, you will be given the certificate. Thank you. Thank you for joining.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Okay. Thanks, Jamal.
Thank you, sir.